Shocks and springs on the X-ray X4 is something that's very similar to shocks and springs on the T4, for the reason that we have retained the ULP type of shock that we had also on the T4. So this well-proven and very well-working shock stays also on the X4. And for that reason, you may be familiar with the build process already, but I'm still gonna guide you through it and try to explain what you need to keep in mind when you build a shock. But first of all, we're gonna talk about spring choices and shock oil. So the kit now comes with progressive hard springs, front and rear, which are the 2.5 to 2.8 hard progressive springs. And these springs provide a very good basic setting, which works for most conditions and makes the car neutral, and it will have very good grip with these springs. It may not always be the fastest setting, but it works very good out of the box. So the team sometimes prefers to run a linear rear spring, so either a 2.6, 2.7, or even 2.8 in the rear, to help to free up the car on high grip conditions. And especially important in stock classes to have a free rear when the rear is not rolling too much. So we often like a linear rear spring. Depending on your driving style, you may want a linear front spring as well, because a linear front spring makes the car initially smoother, doesn't turn in so aggressively. And again, it depends on the conditions that you're racing on to see what spring works the best. But you simply have to try and decide for yourself. But the kit setting is a very good setting for a majority of tracks. So the next thing that I need to mention is the shock oil. So the kit now comes with 400 CST shock oil. This is the same shock oil as is sold by Hoodie. Don't be fooled by the bottle, it's just a smaller bottle to bring you just what you need to build a kit, but it's the same shock oil as the Hoodie shock oil. So 400 is a good basic setting, again, for most conditions, but we have found that on this car, we have gone a bit lighter with the damping. And for that reason, we often like to use piston holes, which are bigger than the 1.1 millimeter, which is the kit setting. And with the bigger piston holes, it allows you to run a heavier shock oil, but still with quite a soft damping rate. And this has benefits when running in hot conditions and basically wherever the shock oil will thin out too much. So the 300 or 350 CST, which we sometimes have run, becomes very soft when it's a hot ambient temperature. So the kit basic setting is a very stable and neutral setting, but if you get a chance, try and go either lighter with a shock oil or use bigger piston holes. So apart from the optional springs and the shock oils, which I just spoke about, we also offer something else which is optional and which is very useful for different conditions. And it's the PSS, the Progressive Shock System, which looks like this. They're little aluminium sleeves which you put into the shock body, and then you use pistons with no holes. So these sleeves, they have a V shape, as you can see. You put a piston inside of the sleeve and it progressively makes the damping harder as it compresses. And this can have a very big benefit on handling. It can make the car more aggressive and can give you more grip. And also this makes the damping more tunable, because you can change the shock length, and by that you can change the starting position of the piston in the shock body. So depending on the shock length you use, for example, if you make the shock longer, the piston is going to sit higher in the shock body and higher in the sleeve, which makes the damping initially harder. Or if you go towards a shorter shock, the piston is going to obviously start in a lower position. You're going to have initially softer damping, which makes the car smoother and not as reactive to drive. So what benefit does the PSS have? For example, if you add the PSS to your front shocks, it's going to keep the front end more level. It's not going to dive down as much off power. It's going to maintain better cornering speed, which is often useful for stock racing, but also for modified racing on higher grip conditions. Also, it can help to prevent traction rolling if you use PSS only in the front of the car. Sometimes we also use it in the rear of the car to improve forward traction, and to sort of lock in the car more in the middle of the corner. So PSS is a very nice tuning option and very popular among the team drivers. But let's move on to building one shock. So shock process is very important because we want to have best possible performance from the shock. First thing I do is I put these little e-clips onto the shock shaft. I do this against a flat surface, so I just push it into the board here so that it clicks onto the shaft. The next thing I do is I take one of the pistons, which I took off the plastic mold tree, and I check it for flashing. So you need to remove these little extra bits of plastic here that's left from the mold. Make sure that it's perfectly round and there's no excess plastic. Then we just stick this onto the shock shaft. And we put the top E-clip in place. For that we're gonna use a Hoodie long nose pliers. Click this into place. Okay, it is done. Next step is we're going to take the O-ring. I'm gonna put some silicone oil on the O-ring. I'm gonna soak this before we put it in the shock body. Take the shock body, put the O-ring inside. Take this little white seal here, the bottom seal below the O-ring. Put the bottom cap on here. Close this up. Then we're gonna take the nut, which adjusts the preload. We're gonna again put a little bit of silicone oil on this O-ring before we install this on the shock body. Okay. I'm gonna put this in place here. All done. Okay, and then we screw this ring or nut onto the shock body here. Get it done, and then we put a shock shaft through the shock body. Make sure there's a little bit of friction here, but not too much. It needs to be moving quite freely because the O-ring should not bind up the movement. Next step is that I take the multi-tool and I hold the shock body and I install the bottom ball cup onto the treads here. So this multi-tool works really great because it's 9 millimeters of width. So when you tighten the ball cup on here to the bottom, it means that the shock is the perfect length for the kit setting, which is 9 millimeters. And it's all done. We're then gonna install the ball cup here onto the pivot ball. Again, we're gonna use the multi-tool. Click that into place like that. And then we're gonna use the same tool to click the ball into the top cap. So we have both pivot balls installed here. The top pivot ball goes in from the shiny side of the top cap. So the shiny side towards the bottom of the ball. And that's in place. And then we can proceed to filling up the shock. Okay, so we're gonna use the Hoodie air vac tool for this procedure. We're gonna fill it up with shock oil. Fill it all the way to the top. And And then move the shock shaft up and down a few times to release the excess air bubbles that are stuck below the piston. And then we put it into the air vac. Put the lid on and we close it. The air vac helps this process to get quicker because we can get rid of the air bubbles in a quicker way, in a more consistent way than just letting the shock rest for a while. So we're gonna need the power cables here. And we're gonna install these into the air vac. I'm just gonna hook this up to my 2-cell battery here, the same battery that I use for the car. You can use a 12-volt power supply, or you can use a 2-cell battery. It also works great, not as powerful, but it still works. And we push the button on the air vac for around 10 to 30 seconds to release all of the air bubbles from the shock oil. You can see the air bubbles slowly getting released from the shock oil. And we let this rest for a minute. Okay, I think that's all done. You can release the pressure from the air vac. You can open it up, or we can take the shock out. Okay. So what I do then is I make sure that the shock shaft is halfway in, not all the way down, not all the way in, halfway. And then I install the membrane, which I gently push into the shock body with a 2mm hex driver. Just push it into place to sort of make it sit in there, to get seated. And in the same procedure, we push out the excess oil so that basically we're getting the shock ready like this. And the rebound will be, the rebound and the pressure will be perfect right away. Then we take the top cap, put the top cap onto the membrane, and finally the nut to close the shock. When you put this on, make sure that you have the little vent hole towards the top so that any air or excess oil can escape through the vent hole. And that's it. We check that we have zero rebound. We prefer to run the shocks with zero rebound because it gives you the most consistent handling, and it will be the most forgiving over bumps as well. If you build your shocks with rebound, it can give you a more direct car, a more direct feeling, which can feel more aggressive, but it's problematic for the reason that when you build your shocks with rebound, they're not going to have rebound for that long. You're going to have to rebuild them quite often to maintain the rebound in the shocks. So not only is it difficult to manage, but also usually makes the car more critical to drive. So we recommend building the shocks with zero rebound, as I've just shown. Dry this off here. Another thing to keep in mind for the X4 is that I said that the sharks have not changed. They have not changed, but the top cap now has two vent holes in it instead of one. So we have two holes here to release the air pressure from above the membrane. So basically this makes it easier to build the sharks with zero rebound. But it also makes it more forgiving on the track because you have a little bit less resistance from the shock. But then I'm gonna install the spring. We offer these aluminium spring retainers in black color, but also in orange color if you want. And they are better than the kit plastic ones for the reason that they're more consistent. They don't flex as much, and they keep the spring in place in a better way than the plastic ones. But in this case, we're just gonna build the shock with the plastic ones. and that's it. I'm happy with that shock build. Rebound was perfect. There's no air inside, and it's ready to go on the car. Now we just have to repeat this process for the remaining three shocks. Okay, so we have these shocks here assembled, which we're now gonna put them on the car. That's the next step in the build progress. And we're gonna remove the rear shock tower to be able to install these shocks. Makes it easier to reach the screw holes. So install the shocks onto the shock tower before installing the shock tower on the car. And those are fitted there. I'm gonna put them on the car here. And then we are going to install two shims at the lower rear shock mounting position, which is a 2mm shim to retain the shocks in a straight angle because of the shape of the arm. So a 2mm shim at the bottom. And this mount on here. That's done. And the front shocks, they don't need any shims, either in the top or the bottom, and we're gonna use the lowest hole here on the tower as well, as I've spoken about in the shocks and springs tech tip. That's the initial setting, is the lowest hole. And in the front, you don't need to remove the shock towers to reach the screws, like you do in the rear. Here you can reach the screws easily with good clearance. Okay. Tighten these down here. And that's it. All the shocks are fitted onto the car, and we can move on to the next step of the build.